They were shocking.
They were horribly gruesome. They were bloody. People were being chopped up and battered with axes. And I'm 9 or 10. I'd never seen anything like this. It was amazing.
Horror comics were, you know, to my little 7, 8-year-old self, they were my pornography. And this was the stuff that I knew I shouldn't be looking at, but, you know, I couldn't give it up.
They were sensational.
They reached deeper and deeper into the springboard barrel. The stories got bloodier and bloodier. Did it go overboard? Yeah, I think so in a couple of spots.
I didn't write it, but I drew it. And I felt very bad about that. Mothers and fathers say, I don't want my kid to read that.
They were controversial.
Well, do you think that this cover is in bad taste? And Bill said, no, I don't think so. How would it be in bad taste? And he said, well, if you showed the gore, drop dripping from it. And they nailed him with that.
And ultimately, they were outlawed.
I think they were all completely shocked when the Senate subcommittee came forward and said, you people are the cause of juvenile delinquency.
The horror comics were a very convenient target. And the powers that be took advantage of that.
My name is William Gaines.
On April 22nd, 1954, William M. Gaines, publisher of Entertaining Comics, testified before the U.S. Senate Subcommittee on Juvenile Delinquency.
I was the first publisher in these United States to publish horror comics. I'm responsible. I started them. Some may not like them. That's a matter of personal taste. It would be just as difficult to explain the harmless thrill of a horror story to a Dr. Wortham as it would be to explain the sublimity of love to a frigid old maid. What are we afraid of? Are we afraid of our own children? Do we forget that they are citizens too and entitled to the essential freedom to read? Or do we think our children so evil, so vicious, so simple-minded that it takes but a comic magazine story of murder to set them to murder, of robbery to set them to robbery?
Just 4 years earlier, Gaines had revolutionized the medium by launching a new trend in comic books, horror. EC's graphically gory tales, while immensely popular with readers, would soon draw the wrath of both parents and politicians and threaten to destroy the entire comic book industry. It could be said that Bill Gaines had comics in his blood. His father, Max, was a pioneer in the medium, creating the first comic book, Famous Funnies, in 1934. 4 years later, Gaines joined ranks with Superman publisher Harry Donenfeld and launched a new line, All-American Comics. Featuring such superheroes as the Green Lantern and Wonder Woman, the AA line was extremely popular, with sales soaring to over 8 million copies per month. Comic books made Max Gaines a fortune. In early 1945, he sold his share of All American for $500,000. He created a new company, Educational Comics, or EC, which published such sedate titles as Picture Stories from the Bible. Not surprisingly, EC's sales languished near the bottom of the industry.
Educational comics were pretty much like educational everything. Nobody wanted to buy them. That's why slowly but surely educational comics morphed into entertaining comics.
Max Gaines changed his company's name and direction, but not its fortunes. Sales continued to lag as children ignored EC in droves. Bill Gaines also wanted nothing to do with his father's comic books. In fact, Bill wanted no part of the family business. Max Gaines had an explosive temper, and Bill often found himself the target of his father's wrath.
From all accounts, the relationship between Bill Gaines and his father was a very hard one and a very little bit abusive on the edge. Max Gaines had built his comic book company out of nothing, and was very impatient with artists and writers, and apparently with his son as well.
He considered Bill the world's biggest klutz. And Bill often tried to live down to that.
Max constantly said to Bill, "You'll never amount to anything."
Bill did his best to stay out of his father's way. After a stint in the Army Air Corps, he enrolled at New York University to pursue his teaching credential. Then in 1947, tragedy struck. Max was killed in a boating accident near the family's summer home on Lake Placid. Prodded by his mother, Bill reluctantly took over the reins at EC.
Bill was not enthusiastic about the idea. His father had been failing. The business owed already about $100,000. Things weren't looking good when he came in. And Bill said, "How do you expect me to do this? My father didn't do it, and he was a pretty smart financial guy."
Gaines slowly learned the ropes and moved the comics more in line with his personal tastes. A turning point came in March 1948, when a 23-year-old artist named Al Feldstein knocked on the door at EC.
I went down to see Bill Gaines, and I showed him the stuff I'd been doing, and he got was very intrigued with them. My girls, they call them headline comics, because I did kind of nubile girls with tight sweaters, you know, a la Lana Turner movies. And so he gave me a contract to do a teenage book called Going Steady with Peggy.
But before even one issue was published, the bottom fell out of the teenage craze. Feldstein agreed to tear up the contract and began working on EC's other titles, imitations of then-popular romance, Western, and crime comics.
After a few years of doing this follow the leader thing, Feldstein and Gaines realized that this was not the way to go. And they realized that they had a common love of the old sort of lights out, inner sanctum radio shows.
Ironized Yeast presents Lights Out, Everybody. Lights Out brings you stories of the supernatural and the supernormal, dramatizing the fantasies and the mysteries of the unknown.
One of the things that I was always fascinated with was the old radio horror shows from Arch Obler, like The Witch's Tale and Lights Out and Inner Sanctum. And I said, why don't we do kind of gothic horror and comics, scare the pants off the kids.
Eager to take the company in a new direction, Gaines agreed to test the waters of horror. Feldstein wrote two stories, The Crypt of Terror and The Vault of Horror, which ran in EC's Crime Comics. Sales improved overnight. Gaines immediately canceled EC's current line and launched what he called a new trend in magazines. In January 1950, The Crypt of Terror and The Vault of Horror hit the newsstands. Two other titles, The Haunt of Fear and Crime Suspense Stories, soon followed. After three issues, Gaines changed the title of The Crypt of Terror to Tales from the Crypt. It would become EC's biggest seller. Early stories featured standard scare fare, such as mummies, vampires, and haunted houses. Gaines and Feldstein soon developed their own signature, simple tales of good and evil, which culminated in an ironic and usually deadly ending.
Every one of those stories would have a twist. Most of those twists were the just dessert twists. That is, whenever there was a really bad person in these comics, they would indeed get their comeuppance, usually in the same way they were delivering it to others.
In one story, titled, "Taint the Meat, It's the Humanity," a mild-mannered butcher named Zach Gristle tries to boost profits by selling spoiled meat to his unsuspecting customers.
Pack your things, Sarah. We're leaving town.
You're in trouble. They found out. I warned you not to sell horse meat.
It's worse than that, Sarah. Four people are dead already. I sold them tainted meat.
You what? You're a murderer!
I did it for us, Sarah. For you and me and Junior.
Junior? He's eating at Herbie Horton's house.
Horton? She bought some of it.
I feel sick, Mommy.
Junior, baby! He's dead, Zach. Dead! You killed him, too! Our son!
Sarah, put down that knife!
Good Lord!
Tainted me? Tainted me, anyone?
EC pioneered dozens of new and ghastly methods of comeuppance. Villains were eaten by ghouls, skewered on swords, buried alive, stuffed down garbage disposals, even southern fried. It gave new meaning to the term, an eye for an eye.
In EC Comics and in much of horror, there's a code that allows the bad guy or the evil force or whatever it is to be, if not vanquished, at least put at bay at the end so we can walk out safely.
Gaines and Feldstein mixed their horror with an element which would become an EC trademark, humor. Its source was quite often the story's narrator, a device they also borrowed from an old radio show.
I had remembered the old witch in The Witch's Tale, and I remember her cackling and laughing and saying, I'm 103 years old today, Satan, and I've got a scary story to tell all my listeners.
And now, Satan, if everybody will just douse out them lights and make it nice and dark, we'll get right down to business. Draw up to the fire and gaze into them embers. Gaze into them deep.
Feldstein created a trio of ghoulish hosts who welcomed readers into the world of the macabre, the Crypt Keeper, the Vault Keeper, and the Old Witch.
Peanuts, popcorn. Yep, it's your feeder of foul fables, the Old Witch, cooking again. Got a circus recipe for you this time.
The humor was a very vital element of these books because if you took these stories out of context, some of them were pretty grisly and some of them were not children's fare. But by having them full of these bad horror puns and having the host come in and wisecrack about them, they kind of took the edge off the horror.
By using the horror hosts, EC kept a perspective on what they were doing, and they reminded their readers that this was fiction and it was entertainment. Certainly it was entertainment. The ghoul lunatics kept the comic horror books comic.
This mix of humor and horror had a tremendous influence on children's author R.L. Stine.
When I started writing these scary books for kids, I thought back to the EC comics and how much I loved them, and I tried to remember what it was about them that I loved so much. And I remembered that it was that amazing mix of horror and humor. There was always a funny twist. People were always making horrible puns about it. It was funny. And it's sort of what I try to do at a much gentler level in my books.
You know, the whole thing was a big joke to Bill. He wanted to publish and have fun and see if he could do stories the way he liked to do it and hope that he made money.
Gaines succeeded beyond his wildest dreams. Although his horror comics didn't match the total sales of Superman, they outsold almost every other comic on a percentage basis, propelling the company into the black.
I think Dad was very surprised that they were as successful as they were. He knew that it was something that he liked and enjoyed, but he wasn't quite sure if anybody else would really enjoy it too. So I think he was surprised and very happy.
An avid reader of science fiction, Gaines followed the horror books with weird science and weird fantasy. Featuring futuristic tales of flying saucers and alien worlds, EC's science fiction books never attained the same level of popularity and success as the horror comics. Yet they are considered by many to be classics of the genre. Although neither man had formal training as a writer, Gaines and Feldstein shared the title of editor. Together, they plotted most of EC's horror and science fiction stories.
Gaines would come in with what he called springboards, and they were story ideas which he got from reading other books, going to movies, and he would pitch them to Feldstein, and Feldstein would turn down the first one and the second one and the fifth one, and someplace around idea number 14, Feldstein would get interested and said, yeah, I can make that work.
Feldstein would then write the story himself, laying it out directly onto the illustration board, which the artist would use to draw the panels. Each horror book had four stories, and it was up to Gaines and Feldstein to create one new tale every day. Scrounging for plots, Gaines read everything he could get his hands on, liberally borrowing from some of the best writers in the field.
Bill would come in with these springboards. He wouldn't tell me what source they were because he didn't want me to steal the story. And he brought in a couple of springboards for science fiction stories, and I liked two of them. And I combined them into something called Home to Stay.
But Gaines's springboards turned out to be two existing stories by Ray Bradbury, then a best-selling author. Bradbury noticed the unauthorized adaptation and wrote to Gaines.
We got a letter from Ray Bradbury. Hey, you guys, you neglected to pay me my royalties for the two stories you swiped. And Bill said, oh, you know, we didn't know how to get in touch with you. And he said, but we'd love to pay you for it. And how about letting us adopt your stories into comics?
With Bradbury's blessing, Feldstein would go on to adapt 26 of the author's short stories. Each one became an instant comic book classic.
Because he is our premier short story writer, his stories were made to order for EC. Every time you think of one of these stories, you tend to rank it as a masterpiece.
Doing the Bradbury adaptations inspired me to be a better writer. And I think that's what EC is really noted for, was that we kind of elevated the level of storytelling to a greater height than had been attained prior in comic books.
EC's stable of artists included some of the most talented men ever to work in the field. Gaines gave them top billing, allowing them to sign their pages, and even publishing their biographies inside the front cover. More importantly, he gave them creative freedom.
Early on, I said to Bill, you know, most comic books have a kind of a sameness to them. I said, what we've got to do is encourage our artists to write in their own handwriting, not to imitate, but to each have their own style.
The styles ran the gamut from squeaky clean to gothically grotesque. Into the latter category fell Graham Ingalls. A painter by training, Ingalls developed a special knack for horror, which earned him the nickname Ghastly.
Graham Ingalls was the greatest guy at drawing walking dead, pieces of flesh falling from bodies. He had this way of getting a texture on the people he was drawing that no one else ever got with this rotten comic book reproduction. Somehow you just felt things oozing out of pores when he drew things.
Graham Ingalls had this way of drawing people, and he made them look like melting wax. There was a feeling of decay about his drawings that was just so appealing in a very kind of under the skin way. I remember looking at his drawings when I was a kid and imagining I could smell it.
At the opposite end of the terror spectrum was Jack Kamen.
Jack Kamen was an illustrator, a very straight kind of illustrator, and he did very pretty girls. Everybody was nice and handsome. I called him the father knows best artist.
Kamen's style was best suited for EC's crime stories, which typically involved love triangles. EC often borrowed plot elements from James M. Cain, whose novels Double Indemnity and The Postman Always Rings Twice were made into very successful movies.
Fix everything for us.
What? Pray for something to happen to Nick?
something like that.
Both Postman and Double Indemnity featured a gorgeous wife who plotted with her boyfriend to kill her husband. Kamen stories usually included both of these elements.
I'm going to kill her, Jean, just like you want. I've made up my mind.
It's the only way, darling. The only way. I knew you'd finally see it.
Of course, in EC's world, as in Kane's, the wife and boyfriend would usually get it themselves in the end. Somewhere in between the styles of Ingalls and Kamen fell EC's other main artists, Johnny Craig and Jack Davis. Craig, the senior member of the staff, was one of the few artists who also wrote his stories. He became the man behind the Vault Keeper, illustrating all of the covers for the Vault of Horror.
Johnny Craig's characters had these severe perspiration problems whenever anything bad happened around them. And you could kind of feel that through the page. You almost felt the page would get damp from all that sweat dripping on it.
Unlike Feldstein and Gaines, who often poured on the gore, Craig focused on the terrors of the mind, the psychological aspects of horror. Considered EC's most popular artist, Jack Davis specialized in physical horror. But Davis, who would later become a highly successful humorist and commercial artist, also had an inherent comic style. He imparted a light touch on even the most horrifying scene.
I love to draw cartoons, and I'm not an illustrator. I think sometimes your illustrators draw just, the stark thing right there. But if I see something, I'll put a cartoon movement on it, an action movement that I would put on a cartoon and exaggerate maybe the hands and the feet and the expression, and really go at it.
That guy just makes me laugh. Even when he's drawing a gross out, he just makes me laugh. There's just something about Jack Davis's stuff that really blows me away.
Probably all of the artists who drew for EC did their best work of their careers during that short time that they were at EC. And that was no accident. That was because Bill found out what they liked to do, and they built the stories around that.
Into their reign of horror, Gaines and Feldstein continued to blaze new trails. In 1952, they launched a new title, Shock Suspense Stories, which featured a series of stories they called preachies, moralistic tales which took on some of the most explosive issues of the day.
What does it say, Dave?
It says, "Don't move in, Jew. You'll be sorry. We don't want Jews in this neighborhood."
Hate was the story of a group of neighborhood vigilantes who try to scare a Jewish family out of town. The situation spirals out of control, and the family is killed. The leader of the vigilantes, John, later makes a shocking discovery.
"I never intended to tell you, John. I never had to. Yes, you're adopted."
"Ma!"
"Your parents, your real parents, were Jewish."
Suddenly, the roles were reversed, and the hater becomes the hated. John gets to experience his bigotry firsthand.
"Can't you see how wrong we've been?"
"Scram, Jew!"
I think Dad liked to be cutting edge. I believe that by touching on areas such as anti-Semitism was just his way of pushing the envelope a little, seeing how far he could go.
I was stunned by the implications of many of the stories they did. These were adult themes. And in a way, they were more shocking than the horror stories because they dealt with reality in a very direct way.
Gaines and Feldstein also turned the spotlight on race relations, a topic which, in the early 1950s, was just beginning to bubble to the surface of public discussion.
He's come home, Andrew. Our Joey's come home a hero.
The whole town's proud of him, Marcia. The whole town, look at him.
But Joey learns that Hank, the soldier who saved his life by jumping on a live grenade, was not good enough to be buried in the town cemetery. In the story's final page, Joey confronts the people of his hometown.
I had a buddy in Korea. We fought for democracy together. He gave his life for that cause. But when his body was sent back here, it wasn't good enough to be buried in Fairlawn Cemetery. It wasn't good enough because its skin wasn't the right color. What did he die for? What did I give my arm for? You say you're proud of me? Well, I'm not proud of you. I'm ashamed. I'm ashamed of you and for you.
We were kind of appealing to better our society, and there were people out that didn't want to better our society. They wanted the status quo.
In 1952, EC launched a new kind of comic book that would tackle the status quo head on. Its title was simply Mad. Masterfully written and edited by Harvey Kurtzman, Mad initially spoofed EC's own comics. Kurtzman soon turned his sights to other targets, and Mad became a runaway hit.
I think the third issue or so, I did The Lone Stranger, and then the one that, where Mad really took off was Super Duper Man. He did a takeoff of Superman, and it was hysterical, and that was the beginning of Mad.
By 1953, Bill Gaines had become one of the most successful publishers in the comic book industry, disproving his father's prophecy that he would never amount to anything.
He was very, very proud that he was able to prove his dad wrong and, you know, turn a business that was suffering into an enormous financial and creative success.
EC's success did not go unnoticed by the other publishers, who soon flooded the newsstands with imitations. By 1953, nearly a quarter of all comic books sold dealt with horror. Gaines, once the trend follower, was now the trendsetter.
The other companies did try to copy EC, but I think that they missed the point. They made the mistake of thinking that it was the gore and the sensational element that made these comic books successful. So, of course, they upped the ante on the gore.
This constant competition and one-upsmanship forced Gaines and Feldstein to raise the level of violence in their stories.
Frankly, as they reached deeper and deeper into the springboard barrel, the stories got bloodier and bloodier. Did it go overboard? Yeah, I think so in a couple of spots.
One spot was foul play. The story of a baseball team which exacts grisly revenge against an opponent who has murdered one of their teammates.
There's no doubt about it. Satin's our murderer. Traces of poison are still on his spikes.
This is a job for the police.
No, wait. Let's take care of him ourselves. Our way.
On the last page, the killer is dismembered and his body parts used as baseball equipment.
I think it's kind of a natural phenomenon to try and top yourself. And yeah, we did step into what might be called extremes in some of the stuff we did, where we became a little gorier than we should have.
I didn't write it, but I drew it. And I felt very bad about that. And of course, everybody really jumped on that, because it was awful, but nowadays it would be nothing. In those days, I guess it was really something. And mothers and fathers say, I don't want my kid to read that.
Stories like Foul Play encouraged critics to step up their attacks. The most vocal critic was Frederick Wortham, a New York psychiatrist who had worked with troubled teens. Wortham's attack on comic books began in 1948, when he called the medium pollution from which children had to be protected. In the spring of 1954, Wortham's book, Seduction of the Innocent, was published. Promoted as the most shocking book of the year, it was a scathing indictment of all comic books.
Wortham, of course, as a psychiatrist, read everything into these comic books that you possibly could. He talked about a homoerotic relationship between Batman and Robin. He talked about the lesbian tendencies of Wonder Woman. It was preposterous.
Wortham saved his harshest attacks for horror and crime comics, which he alleged were a direct cause of juvenile delinquency. These claims touched off a firestorm of criticism against the comics industry. PTA and church groups organized boycotts. Others took even more drastic measures.
There were comic book burnings that were, of course, reminiscent of the Nazi years. Nobody intended that precisely, but when you saw some of these ugly scenes of towns where they would get all the comic books together and just burn them up, it was quite frightening.
The controversy quickly drew the attention of political leaders, and the U.S. Senate Subcommittee to Investigate Juvenile Delinquency agreed to look into the matter. Led by Tennessee Senator Estes Kefauver, the panel held hearings in New York City on April 21, 1954. The star witness was none other than Dr. Frederick Wortham.
It is my opinion, without any reasonable doubt and without any reservation, that comic books are an important contributing factor in many cases of juvenile delinquency.
Wortham worked from an improper premise, that is, he decided that the troubled children that he was analyzing read comic books. Therefore, that was a source of their trouble. And of course, there were plenty of children reading comic books who were leading perfectly normal lives, and in fact, most of them were very happy.
As adults, we get to a certain age, and all of a sudden we stop being inside, we stop wanting to take chances. We start being more afraid of the world, and we start protecting our children. We don't realize what it was like to be a kid. And so here comes Seduction of the Innocent. Claims that these comic books are gonna turn us kids into juvenile delinquents. Well, poor guy, I have news for him. They turned me into a movie director. I didn't become a juvenile delinquent. This guy's dead wrong. Dead wrong.
My name is William. Although many of the attacks were directed at other publishers, Bill Gaines asked for and was granted permission to testify before the committee.
I was the first publisher in these United States to publish horror comics. I'm responsible. I started them. Some may not like them. That's a matter of personal taste. It would be just as difficult to explain the harmless thrill of a horror story to a Dr. Wortham as it would be to explain the sublimity of love to a frigid old maid. My father was proud of the comics he published, and I'm proud of the comics I published.
Gaines defended his books on the grounds of free speech. He told the committee that he felt constrained only by the limits of good taste.
What happened was, of course, Bill was not astute enough or experienced enough to be able to parry some of the "when did you stop beating your wife" questions that came flying at him after his testimony.
One of those questions concerned a recent issue of EC's crime suspense stories.
"Do you think that this cover is in bad taste?" And Bill said, "No, I don't think so." "How would it be in bad taste?" And he said, "Well, if you showed the gore, dripping from it." And they nailed him with that.
The exchange made front page news and turned public opinion decisively against Gaines.
Bill's mistake was, by volunteering to testify, he focused all the negativity on himself and EC Comics. So now the villain, the evil comic book publisher, now had a face and a name, and that name was William M. Gaines.
The Senate hearings quickly turned up the heat on EC. Wholesalers began refusing to handle Gaines's comics. Bundles were returned to the office unopened. Attempting to rally the other comic book publishers, Gaines proposed an association to fight the growing witch hunt.
So he called a meeting to say, let's fight this censorship as a group. And the other publishers had a wonderful idea about how to fight the censorship. Let's get rid of the violence, let's get rid of the horror, let's wipe out all of the stuff that EC does, and then we'll all be very happy.
Gaines stormed out of the meeting, leaving the other publishers to form the Comics Magazine Association of America. The group immediately outlawed the use of the words crime, horror, terror, and weird, all of which had figured prominently in EC's biggest sellers. The publishers also established a code of ethics, which forbade all scenes of horror, excessive bloodshed, and gory or gruesome crimes. All comics which complied with the code would receive the association's seal of approval. Judge Charles Murphy, a New York City magistrate, was appointed the first code administrator, the comics czar. Ostracized by the other publishers, and with no wholesalers willing to handle his comics, Gaines was forced to surrender. On September 14, 1954, he announced that he was discontinuing his line of horror and crime comics.
I, for one, do not believe, and never have believed, that comics are the cause of juvenile delinquency. I've taken this action based on a premise which has never been proven. However, I feel that the public must be served. If this is the way the public wants it, this is the way it'll have to be as far as I'm concerned.
I was too young to pay attention to the Kefauver hearings. All I knew is that one day I couldn't find my EC comics anymore. And I was left with, you know, Superman and Batman and, you know, just, you know, whatever was left. You know, they were good, but it wasn't the same.
The new comics code put a dozen publishers out of business overnight. Gaines, however, was not ready to throw in the towel. Instead, he and Feldstein created a new, clean line of comics, which they called, appropriately, their new direction. Although they refused to join the association, EC's new comics stuck to the letter of the code.
Gaines tried putting out comics without the Comics Code symbol, and he didn't get on the newsstands. The books would be printed, they'd be shipped out to wholesalers, the wholesalers would just take them and ship them right back for credit, and Gaines was suddenly now unable to get his comics to the customers.
Gaines had no choice but to swallow his pride and join the association. He had a difficult time, however, winning approval for any of his stories.
Initially, when the Comics Code was started, its mission was to prove it was necessary. So they started ripping stories apart, deleting things which, in hindsight, seemed ridiculous. Most censorship drives seem ridiculous in hindsight, but these seemed especially ridiculous even at the time.
I think that his mission was to put us out of business, or at least make it so impossible for us to publish that Bill would quit.
Gaines quickly became frustrated with the code's censorship. This is what our forefathers came to America to escape, he told his distributors.
Dad was a very good Indian chief, but he wasn't a good squaw. He didn't follow really well. And to be in a position where he had to present his material and have someone else decide whether it was appropriate or not was very difficult for him.
After a year of working under the code censors, EC finally had it out with Judge Murphy.
We had a science fiction story about mutants that he completely refused to let us run. And so I brought a replacement story.
The replacement story was called Judgment Day and had run 3 years earlier in Weird Fantasy. The story was one of Gaines and Feldstein's preachies, an allegory about racial tolerance. In it, a space investigator visits a planet inhabited by orange and blue robots to determine if they were advanced enough to join the Galactic Empire.
You differentiate between blue robots and orange robots?
Of course. Otherwise, there'd be trouble. Have to keep them in their place, you know.
After determining that prejudice existed among the robots based on the color of their armor, the investigator concluded they were not yet ready to join the Empire. Upon returning to his spaceship, the investigator removed his helmet, revealing African-American features.
Well, Judge Murphy said, no, you can't have that. I said, you can't have what? He said, you can't have a black man. I said, that's the point of the whole story. He says, you can't have a black man. I said, where in the code does it say I can't have a black man? Can't have a black man. He wouldn't let it go.
Feldstein returned to the EC offices and informed Gaines of Murphy's edict.
And Bill called up Judge Murphy and he said, what's going on? And Judge Murphy said, you can't have a black man. I said, and Bill said, I'm calling a press conference and I'm gonna make a big stink about the bigotry of the code. And he said, all right, he can be a black man, but you gotta take the perspiration off his skin. Bill said the four-letter word, you, and hung up on him and ran the story, and I think that was the end of our science fiction comic book.
Gaines had had enough. Judgment Day became the last story in the last comic book that EC ever published.
The whole thing kind of crashed and burned. It slowly wound down. Unfortunately for Bill, he had an ace in the hole with Mad Magazine.
Although Mad had started slowly when it was launched in 1952, 3 years later, it was selling like hotcakes. In the summer of 1955, editor Harvey Kurtzman convinced Gaines to change the 10-cent comic book into a 25-cent black and white magazine. 1 year later, after a falling out over ownership of the magazine, Gaines fired Kurtzman and replaced him with Al Feldstein. Mad didn't miss a beat. Over the next 25 years, it became one of the most popular and successful magazines in America.
Even though the EC Comics died a terrible death, they've come back alive decades later, bigger and better than ever. And I think it's almost a classic case of comeuppance. This time, the good guys got what they deserved.
EC's resurrection began in 1972, when a British company, Amicus Films, released a film version of Tales from the Crypt. Featuring Joan Collins and Peter Cushing, it adapted five comic book horror stories.
Tales from the Crypt, rated PG.
EC's horror comics served as inspiration for numerous filmmakers. Director George A. Romero grew up reading Tales from the Crypt.
I discovered EC Comics when I was a kid, and they weren't allowed in the house. I would smuggle them in and, you know, the classic thing, get under the covers with a flashlight and read them. And I just loved them.
Romero credits EC with indirectly influencing many of his films, including the cult classic, Night of the Living Dead.
I have at times, particularly in the first Night of the Living Dead, tried to do the real hard shadows and the weird angles and beautiful lighting that a comic book artist can create. I really tried to do that sort of framing. Undoubtedly was influenced by EC. Those books almost acted as a library, a reference library, for anyone interested in working in horror.
In the early 1980s, Romero proposed a collaboration with famed horror writer Stephen King.
And I suggested, you know, why don't we do an anthology? And Steve said, well, if we're gonna do an anthology, I think we should do sort of an homage to EC because we both loved it and wouldn't it be fun? A week later, he called up and said, I got the title, it's called Creepshow. We tried to give it a comic book look, and for the comic book itself that appears in the movie and the panels that appear as drawings, Jack Kamen did those, who was an EC, one of the EC artists. The stories each started with a the first page and a move in on the illustration. We use the little yellow banners for narration. We actually pan sometimes over to the next panel, although they were moving. And then we use colored lights and gobos and graphics that, you know, like, that would wing come out of people's heads. And we just tried to have as much fun as we could and make it really look like a comic book.
John Carpenter is another Hollywood director whose career path was influenced by EC.
There's some really scary and really cool stuff in those comic books. And to be able to redo that visually and to keep the same spirit alive of those books in movies was great. I would say that the movie Like the Fog is a direct connection to EC. You see the rotting corpses walking up. I mean, you can't get closer than that. One of the things that The Fog had in it was the vengeance of the dead. And I remember in EC Comics, that was always a big deal. There was somebody was murdered unfairly by someone else.
I'm the sixth conspirator. I'm Father Malone. Take me.
Often in the very end, the corpse would come back to get its revenge. Well, I thought that was really cool. That was hot. It just had kind of great irony to it.
While EC found new life in the visions of directors they had inspired, the comic books themselves made their own resurgence in the late 1970s. Working from the original artwork which Bill Gaines had stored in a New York City vault, publisher Russ Cochran reprinted EC's comics in handsomely bound hardcover volumes. The complete EC library proved to be enormously popular among collectors and fans.
I get letters all the time of people saying, thank you for publishing these. I loved these when I was a kid. I never thought I'd see them again. And now I can get them again. And I'm really enjoying it.
In the mid-1980s, the Cochran reprints caught the attention of several Hollywood producers, including Joel Silver, who had produced such hits as Lethal Weapon and Die Hard.
I remember as a kid, I would devour these comic books. I mean, they were scary, they were funny. They were just so special. There was nothing else like them. So we pursued Bill Gaines, and we said we'd like to get the rights to Tales from the Crypt.
Silver, together with partners David Giler and Walter Hill, optioned the rights with the idea of producing an anthology film. Directors Richard Donner and Robert Zemeckis eventually became partners in the project. In the late 1980s, the group abandoned the idea of a feature film and decided to turn Tales from the Crypt into a television series. The pilot episode, directed by Robert Zemeckis, was based on a story in which a homicidal maniac dressed as Santa Claus terrorizes a woman who has just killed her husband. During production, Silver and Zemeckis sought advice from Bill Gaines.
When we showed the rough cut to Bill, he said at the end of the show, she should be screaming her head off.
Oh, Carrie, thank goodness.
See, Mommy, I told you Sam would come, and he didn't even have to come down the chimney. I let him in.
No!
Was absolutely involved in the creation of the first episode. And we always looked at that episode as a template for all future episodes.
The series producers, all fans of the comic books, remained faithful to the EC spirit.
If you read the stories in the comic book and then you see our versions of the stories, they're very true to them. I mean, we really didn't take a lot of liberties, and we tried to kind of capture, you know, the images from the comic book and use those images almost like a storyboard for the shows.
The series also brought to life Gaines and Feldstein's horror host, the Crypt Keeper.
We all felt it was very important that the Crypt Keeper be a part of the show, because we loved the notion of this little weird guy who was funny and scary. You know, he could make you laugh, but he could kill you.
Although he bore little physical resemblance to his comic book counterpart, the animatronic Crypt Keeper did speak in the same punning patter.
Greetings, infestors. I'll be with you in a moment. I was just putting these gross profits away for safekeeping. You see, boils and ghouls, at Crypt Keeper Financial, we can help you get morgue for your money. Whether it's mutual fiends you want or cold, horrid cash, we can guarantee you'll coroner the market.
The key to the Crypt Keeper is that he's comedy relief. He sometimes can get a little ghoulish, but never really over the top. He's there to ease the pain of being scared, perhaps.
Jack Wall is the president of Tales from the Crypt Productions and is the marketing mastermind behind the flood of Crypt Keeper merchandise.
But I said there's no reason in the world that the Crypt Keeper can't be for Halloween what Santa Claus is for Christmas. That was a tall order. We're gaining on it. He is slowly but surely becoming what I like to call the world's undisputed icon of ghoul horror and spooktacular fun.
It was just exciting that we were able to create this kind of whole, you know, world out of these very secret, special, magical comic books.
Once banished by parents and politicians, Tales from the Crypt and the other EC horror comics of the 1950s have taken on the air of legitimacy and earned their rightful place as a piece of treasured Americana.
What's amazing is how much the EC books are remembered. There were hundreds and hundreds of comic books coming out every month in the 50s that no one remembers, that no one collects, that no one bases current fiction on inspirations of. And yet these EC books seem to have crept into the sensibilities of a whole generation or two.
They were so smart and they were so interesting, and the art was so great, and it was so well done, and they really were so pure in what they were.
These EC horror comics are classic. They're classic horror stories. They're still wonderful today, and I think this is why people love them. They haven't dated at all.
I think EC comics are the greatest comics ever invented because they dare to be appalling and funny and crazy and witty, all in one big wild ball of human commentary.
Al Feldstein is considered to be one of the most talented writers and editors ever to work in comic books. He retired from Mad Magazine in 1984 and now lives on a ranch in Montana, where he paints wildlife scenes and recreations of his famous horror and science fiction covers.
I consider myself a very fortunate human being in having had a career that I loved, that I enjoyed doing, and fortunate that I had the opportunities presented to me by Bill and his open creative publishing. He had a great capacity for letting people with talent shine, and for that I'm eternally grateful.
William M. Gaines died in 1992. To the general public, he is perhaps best remembered as the colorful and iconoclastic publisher of Mad. But to fans around the world, he is considered the heart and soul of the company that forever changed the face of comic books.
Bill Gaines just didn't give a damn. He liked his comics the way they did them. And if you wanted to go along for the ride, great. And if you didn't, screw it.
He was absolutely thrilled with the support from EC fans. You know, he came into the business not knowing anything about the comic book industry, and he just did what he liked. And he was amazed to find that everyone else liked it too.
Like her father before her, Wendy Gaines Bucci has taken over the family business and has become the guardian of the EC legacy.
When I was younger, EC didn't really mean a whole lot to me. I just knew it was something that my dad had done at one time. And as I grew older and started to become familiar with the material and read the old comic books, I realized he was a genius and I never knew it. He was way ahead of his time and created something that he was very proud of and we were all very proud of as well.
Thank you.